He rebuked the Red Sea also, and it was dried up. So he led them through the depths as through the wilderness. Psalm 106, verse 9. Israel at the Red Sea. A sermon delivered on Sabbath morning, March the 30th, 1856, by C.H. Spurgeon. Several Sabbaths ago, we preached upon the deliverance of the children of Israel out of Egypt by the blood of the Passover, and we told you then that we believed that event to be typical of the coming forth of God's people from that spiritual house of bondage, that furnace of mental suffering, whence they are delivered by the omnipotent grace of God at the time of their conversion. This morning we pursue the narrative. No doubt the children of Israel supposed that now all was over. The Egyptians had sent them away, entreating them to depart, and loading them with riches. Terror had smitten the heart of Egypt, for from the king on the throne to the prisoner in the dungeon, all was dismay and fear on account of Israel. Egypt was glad for them when they departed. Therefore the children of Israel said within themselves, "We shall now march to Canaan at once. There will be no more dangers, no more troubles, no more trials. The Egyptians themselves have sent us away, and they are too much afraid of us ever to molest us again. Now we shall tread the desert through with hasty footstep, and when a few more days have passed, we shall enter into the land of our possession, the land that floweth with milk and honey." "Not quite so speedily," says God. "The time is not arrived yet for you to rest. It is true I have delivered you from Egypt, but there is much you have to learn before you will be prepared to dwell in Canaan. Therefore I shall lead you about, and instruct you, and teach you." And it came to pass that the Lord led the children of Israel about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, till they arrived over against Baal Zephon, when on either side the craggy mountains shut them in. Pharaoh hears of it. He comes upon them to overcome them, and they stand in terrible fright and jeopardy of them to overcome them. And they stand in terrible fright and jeopardy of their lives. Now, beloved, it is usually so with the believer. He marches out of Egypt spiritually at the time of his conversion, and he says within himself, "Now I shall always be happy." He has a bright eye and a light heart, for his fetters have been dashed to the ground, and he feels no longer the lash of conscience upon his shoulder. "Now," says he, "I may have a short life, but it will be a happy one. A few more rolling years at most will land me on fair Canaan's coast. And then I shall have no more warfare, no more fighting, no more disturbance, but I shall be at peace." "Not quite as thou desirest," says God. "O thou little one, I have more to teach thee ere thou art prepared for my palace." Then he commences to lead us about and bring us into straits and perils. The sins which we thought had utterly left us are hunting us behind, while impassable floods block up the way. Even trembling Israel, halting by the Red Sea, is but a faint emblem of that terrible position into which the child of God usually falls, within a few weeks or months after he has come out of the land of Egypt. I shall preach this morning a sermon, which I hope will be useful to such of you as have lately come to know the Lord. You were expecting to build tabernacles in which to dwell on the summit of the mountains of joy forever, but you found, on the contrary, that you have very great troubles and conflicts, and perhaps now you have a more terrible trial than you ever experienced in all your life before. I will endeavour to show you that this is just what you might have expected, that there will be a Red Sea very soon after you come out of your house of bondage. Others of you, my dear friends, have passed through all these things many years ago. You can say, "Many days have passed since then, many changes I have seen, yet have been upheld till now. Who could hold me up but thou?" I am sure you'll be glad to revisit the spot where God delivered you from your distresses. We find it very pleasant to look upon the place where we were taught in our schoolboy days, or to visit the haunts of our childhood. So you who are grey-headed in the cause of your master will not find it very tedious work to go back a little way and look to that Red Sea which God rebuked and dried up, that you might be led through it even as through the wilderness. Coming then to the subject, the children of Israel had their difficulties, and so generally the child of God has his, very soon after he comes out of Egypt. But then they had their refuges. And moreover, God had a great and grand design to answer in all the troubles into which they were brought. Taking the first point, the children of Israel just now had three difficulties, three exceeding great dangers. And so I believe that every heir of heaven, within a very short period after the time of his deliverance, will meet with the same. The first they had was a great trial sent by God himself. There was the Red Sea in front of them. Now it was not an enemy that put the sea there, it was God himself. We may therefore think that the Red Sea represents some great and trying providence, which the Lord will be sure to place in the path of every newborn child, in order to try his faith and to test the sincerity of his trust in God. I do not know, beloved, whether your experience will back up mine, but I can say this, that the worst difficulty I ever met with, or I think I can ever meet with, happened a little time after my conversion to God. And you must generally expect, very soon after you've been brought to know and love him, that you will have some great, broad, deep Red Sea straight before your path, which you will scarcely know how to pass. Sometimes it will occur in the family. The husband says, for instance, if he is an ungodly man, "You shall not attend such and such a place of worship. I positively forbid you to be baptized or to join that church." There is a Red Sea before you. You had done nothing wrong. It is God himself who places that Red Sea before your path. Or perhaps before that time you were carrying on a business which now you cannot conscientiously continue. And there is a Red Sea which you have to cross in renouncing your means of livelihood. You don't see how it is to be done, how you are to maintain yourself and to provide things honest in the sight of all men. Or perhaps your employment calls you amongst men with whom you lived before on amicable terms, and now on a sudden they say, "Come, won't you do as you used to do?" There again is a Red Sea before you. It is a hard struggle. You do not like to come out and say, "I cannot, I shall not, for I am a Christian." You stand still, half afraid to go forward. Or perhaps it is something proceeding more immediately from God. You find that just when he plants a vine in your heart, he blasts all the vines in your vineyard. And when he plants you in his own garden, then it is that he uproots all your comforts and your joys. Just when the sun of righteousness is rising upon you, your own little candle is blown out. Just when you seem to need it most, your gourd is withered, your prosperity departs, and your flood becomes an ebb. I say again, it may not be so with all of you, but I think that most of God's people have not long escaped the bondage of Egypt before they find some terrible, rolling sea, lashed perhaps by tempestuous winds, directly in their path. They stand aghast and say, "Oh God, how can I bear this? I thought I could give up all for thee, but now I feel as if I could do nothing. I thought I should be in heaven and all would be easy, but here is a sea I cannot ford. There is no squadron of ships to carry me across. It is not bridged even by thy mercy. I must swim it, or else I fear I must perish." Then the children of Israel had a second difficulty. They would not have cared about the Red Sea a single atom if they had not been terrified by the Egyptians who were behind them. These Egyptians, I think, may be interpreted this morning by way of parable as the representatives of those sins of ours, which we thought were clean, dead, and gone. For a little while after conversion, sin does not trouble a Christian. He is very happy and cheerful in a sense of pardon. But before many days are passed, he will understand what Paul said. I find another law in my members, so that when I would do good, evil is present with me. The first moment when he wins his liberty, he laughs and leaps in an ecstasy of joy. He thinks, oh, I shall soon be in heaven. As for sin, I can trample that beneath my feet. But mark you, scarce has another Sabbath gladdened his spirit, ere he finds that sin is too much for him. The old corruptions which he fancied were laid in their graves get a resurrection and start up afresh, and he begins to cry, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? He sees all his old sins galloping behind him, like Pharaoh and his host pursuing him to the borders of the Red Sea. There is a great trial before him. Oh, he thinks he could bear that. He thinks he could walk through the Red Sea. Oh, those Egyptians, they are behind him.